Welcome to WHBC TV. I'm Dr. Tadeu Boboi, the lead pastor of Wema. I greet you today with Christ's joy, and this is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and we'll be glad in it. We made up our mind. We'll make up our mind to rejoice in it, no matter what the situation or the circumstances that this broadcast has met you this morning. You can rejoice in the joy of the Lord. This morning, we're going to be continuing our message series in the book of Philippians called Looking for Happy. And this morning we're going to hear from Paul in Philippians chapter 2 that we don't need to look for happy like the world do, because if you are a believer, you have the joy of the Lord in you, and that joy of the Lord can be your strength. And this morning we're going to go back to the message that we began 2 weeks ago, over getting over yourself. And this morning we're going to talk about how we can get over ourselves in Philippians chapter 2, when Paul is saying, do not do anything with selfishness or out of selfishness or with empty conceit, but do all things with humility. And this morning we're going to be talking about how we can get over ourselves. Why don't you get a pen and a paper and come into the sanctuary and join the people of God? I tell you, heaven came down and glory filled our soul as we went into the word this morning. And you will be blessed too. In Jesus' name, I'll come back and pray with you. As we continue in our message series in the book of Philippians called Looking for Happy, Experiencing Outrageous Joy. With a smile in your face and a joy in your heart, just turn to your neighbor and say, are you looking for happy? I've titled the message to you this morning, He's the name above all names. He's the name above all names. Before you take your seat, just greet somebody next to you that you haven't greeted yet and say, His is the name above all names. His is the name above all names. Praise God. Praise God. You may be seated. You may be seated as our young people, as our youth goes to their Sunday school. Amen. You may be seated as our youth goes to their Sunday school. Glory to God. His name is the name above all names. If you've been with us for the past one month, to be precise, 1 month we've been in this series. If you've been with us for the past 1 month, you will know that we've been looking at Paul's letters to the Christians in Philippi. A letter that is known as an epistle of joy. So far, Paul has been reminding us and his original readers that if you are a true believer in Jesus Christ, you don't need to look for happy like the world do. Because you've got the joy of the Lord in you. That was our first message in the series. I've got the joy. If you've got the joy, tell someone, I've got the joy. Then we talked about why you can be joyful. Because you can tell someone to PBPGINFWMYU. You know what that means, don't you? Please be patient. God is not finished with me yet. Or is he? And since God isn't finished with you yet, you can be an all-weather Christian. Because the joy of the Lord we're talking about is not a joy that is contingent
on any circumstances, but it's a joy that knows God is good all the time. And all the time, God is good. Amen. Even when it doesn't seem like it, is working it out for your good. Can I get a witness from all my Romans chapter 9 verse 28 Christians in here? But the last time we were together in chapter 2, we had a pretty challenging message from Paul. I thought it was very challenging. I thought it was really in your face, telling us we need to get over ourselves. We need to get over ourselves if we don't want to make our lives miserable. If we don't want to be la miserable. Is that how you say in French? Le miserable. Le miserable. Anyone here wants to be le miserable? If you do, because it is true, misery loves company. Chances are some of us just like to be miserable. If you do, Paul says, the two quickest way to get you there is to first of all be selfish. And then be prideful. Those were the 2 points I gave to you in our last message. But isn't it true that the most selfish people and the most prideful people are often the most miserable people you know? Have you ever met a joyful, selfish person or a joyful, prideful person? Don't look around here. What is true? Sally, give me the light point. You're doing well. What is true is a man wrapped up in himself makes for a small package. Selfish people think they are big, but they are really small. That's good. That's tweetable. I'm already preaching. Let me say that again. If you are a person who is wrapped up in yourself and everything is all about you and your middle name is me, then you make for a pretty small package. Oh, church, can I preach this thing like I know it? Because somebody's marriage is about to be saved this morning. And a friendship that is about to hit the rock is about to be restored this morning. In the early years of my marriage, I was so self-centered in my attitude and in my actions that I was basically saying to my wife Marian, what is yours is mine, and what is mine is mine. Somebody missed that. I say, you may think that you are all that and a bag of potato chips too, but Paul says to tell you in verse 3 of Philippians chapter 2 that if you don't want the rest, if you don't want the life, the rest of your life to be miserable, then do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit. In other words, you need to get over yourself. I need to get over myself. We all need to get over ourselves, because at the root of any disharmony in the church and divorces in a marriage and unrest in a workplace and upheaval in the nation is the sin called selfishness and pride. Hello, somebody. It was a sin that brought Satan from glory. Oh. So last time the message was, get over yourself. Look at someone. Look at someone you love. Look at someone you love and tell them, get over yourself. Ah, I like that. I like that. I like that. I like that. I'm seeing some wife going like this. Some ribs are going to be sore this morning. This way they won't get mad at you, because Paul is the one who is telling you to tell them, get over yourself. So this way they won't be mad at you that you're blunt. Now today we're going to talk about how to get over ourselves. Last week, two weeks ago, when I shared that text with you, I just told you the two things that can make us miserable. Selfishness and pride. But I didn't tell you how we should get over ourselves. So this morning we're going to talk about the cure for selfishness and pride. Just how do you get over yourself? Even if you want to, how do you do it? The answer, the cure, is right here in verse 3. Church, are you ready to receive? Here's the cure. Be humble. To be miserable, you would have to be selfish and be prideful. But to be joyful, you have to be humble. Oh, this is going to be good. Paul says in verse 3, do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with what, church? Everybody say humility. With humility of mind, let each of you regard one another as more important than himself. Good Lord. Wow, that's tough. For me to regard that person, who doesn't like me, who hates my guts, and I know it too. For me to regard that person as more important than me, Mr. Bolland, that's tough. Years ago, there was this funny song. There was this funny song about humility. The lyrics goes like this. Oh Lord, it's hard to be humble when you're perfect in every way. I can't wait to look in the mirror, because I get better looking each day. To know me is to love me. I must be a heck of a man. Oh Lord, it's hard to be humble, but I'm doing the very best. Try to sing that to yourself. Men, isn't it humbling at times when God uses our wives to humble us? Don't leave me up here by myself. My wife Marian knows how to humble me every now and then. Like a pastor who was cleaning his house one day. And as he came to the bedroom, he went under the bed to clean the bed, to vacuum the bed. And lo and behold, he found a basket under the bed with 5 eggs and $1,000. Shocked, baffled, he called his wife and said, "Darling, what is this little basket under the bed with 5 eggs and $1,000 doing under our bed?" Oh, the pastor's wife said, "I must confess that every time you preach a bad sermon, I put an egg in the basket." Secretly, the pastor was ecstatic. Not bad. 5 eggs for 5 sermons. Bad sermons, 5 bad sermons, 5 eggs for 5 bad sermons. Haven't been preaching for almost 25 years. He thought to himself, not bad. 5 eggs, not bad. So he asked his wife, "And what about this $1,000? And the pastor's wife replied, "Well, anytime I get a dozen, I sell it." Come on now. I know my wife knows. My wife knows how to humble me like that sometimes. I'll go home like, "Oh, I hit that home run." And she said, "Ty, sit down. That thing you said, come on." But humility is a word that has gotten bad rep in our day. You hear the word humility, and we think of humility. When we think of humility, we think of the humble person as someone who thinks they are not worth anything. A scumbag, if you will. But Paul is going to show us here this morning that nothing can be further from the truth. Humility is not low self-esteem. Give me the lifeline. You're doing good. Humility is not thinking less of yourself. Humility is thinking of yourself less. Oh, that's good. Because some of us we're suffering from a disease. We're suffering from what is called false humility. Walking around like this. And saying, "I'm not worthy. I'm not worthy. I'm a worm." Hey! You are what? That's not humility. Wrong. That's self-loathing. Don't you know that you're fearfully and wonderfully made by God? And you're going, "I'm a worm." No. Look at what verse 4 says. Let's understand what humility, biblical humility, means. Look at what verse 4 says. Notice it says, "Do not merely look out for your own personal interest." It's not saying ignore your own interest. It says, "Do not merely," that's the operative word, "do not merely look out for you, but look out for others too." Don't just be a me person. Can I take you deeper in this? Write this down if you're writing. Biblical humility is like meekness. Write it down. Biblical humility is like meekness. You know, meekness is not weakness. Meekness is strength under control. And humility is like that. Honestly, don't you love being around humble people? But a proud, arrogant, pompous, bombastic. Give me another superlative. Eh? A what? A what? They're aggravating, yes. Because it is true. A private person is one who makes everybody around them sick except himself. Oh, to be sure. Paul could have called up Moses as an example of one who was humbled. For the Bible says in Numbers chapter 12 verse 3, the Bible says, now the man Moses was very humble. Now, I just saw something there. You know who wrote Numbers, don't you? Who authored the book of Numbers? Thank you, Moses. I got a good Bible student here. Moses, he wrote the Pentateuch, the five books of the law. Can you imagine Moses writing himself? And now Moses was very humble, man. Now, what would you think of Moses? Now, if you're humble and you're saying, I'm a humble person, right away, just pocket that humble. Because if you're humble, you don't tell people you're humble. I just saw something. This was a commentary. Look at it. It's in bracket. It's in bracket in your Bible. It's in bracket. It's in bracket meaning from the rest of the verses 1 and 2, Moses is the one writing. But now God said, Moses, stop. I want to interject. I want to put my own commentary. He put it in parentheses. Now Moses, this is God speaking. Now the man Moses, Moses can't call himself the man Moses. God is speaking now. Now the man Moses was very humble, more than any man who was on the face of the earth. That's a good commentary anyone can ever get from God. If God can say you are humble, and it doesn't get into your head, you're good. But even Moses blew it with his temper at one time. So what may be true of other examples is not true of the one epic example of humility that Paul is about to call up for us this morning. So as we come to our text, he says in effect, you want to know how to get over yourself. You would like for instance, to help you better understand what looking out for the interests of others look like. Then I call before you the perfect example, Jesus. You take a look at how he humbled himself. This is the attitude you want to have in yourself. Verse 6. Ooh, this is going to be good. Who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped. Verse 7. But emptied himself. Oh, I feel like preaching right now. Can anybody hear what is going on here? Can anybody see what heaven is seeing right now? Can anybody feel what all of heaven is feeling right now? Paul, speaking of Jesus, says, who, although he existed in the form of God, meaning the very essence of God. That's what the Greek word form, morphe, form, the Greek word form, morphia, it means the very essence, not diluted, not toned down, the real deal. This is as God gets. Philip one time says, Jesus, show us the Father. And what did Jesus say to Philip? Thank you. Who Jesus, although existed, although he is God, and did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, to hold on to fight for, but he emptied himself, taking the form of a servant. You mean the King of Kings? And the Lord of Lords? The King of Glory we were singing about this morning left the glory of heaven? His glory is so illuminating that heaven needs no sun. He, Jesus, is the one seated on the throne before the 24 elders across a sea of glass like crystals. He is the Ancient of Days, Jehovah Sukenu, the Lord our righteousness. He is Jehovah Makadesh, the Lord who sanctifies. He is Jehovah Shammah, the Lord who is there. He is Jehovah Nissi, the Lord who is my banner. He is Jehovah Rapha, the healer. He's never weak. He's never sick. He's never broke. He's never needy. Oh. He never runs out. He never goes dry. And yet Paul says, this very God, Antivai, allows himself to become a man. Oh, somebody's missing. Somebody's still missing this. The hugeness of what Paul wants us to see here this morning. My brothers and my sisters, let me help you enter into this. I was feeling the glory of God as we're worshiping this morning. As we're singing the saving one. Let me help you enter into this. He the creator. He the creator. Came down. Verses 6 to 8 is one step down after the other. First, the maker of man. Don't miss this. I want everybody, if you have your hand folded, release it. Because glory is in this house right now. Don't miss this. I want you to feel what all of heaven was feeling. He the maker. Don't miss every step. Feel every step he took down. And then you'll be able to enter into it. He the maker became a man. The Bible says he emptied himself. That's the first step. Second step. Then he took the form of a bond servant. Not just a servant. He took the form of a doulos. Everybody said doulos. Go home and check what doulos means. As if that wasn't enough, he took the third step. Oh, we're running out of step here. as if it wasn't condescending enough. Verse 8 says, he humbled himself by being obedient to the point of death. Then comes another step. I don't have steps. Comes another step, a humiliating step, a painful step, an agonizing step, to the extent that Paul didn't just say he died. But the last statement of verse 8 says, even death, or even death on the cross. Some of you are already feeling it. The word even here is calling you to see how shocking this Christ's ultimate humility and humiliation is. This is the bottom of the bottomest, if there's any English word for it. This is the lowest anyone can descend into. I mean, what can be more lower and agonizing than hell? Oh, talk to me, somebody. If you've ever been through hell and high waters and come back, you can look and say to the devil, what more can you do to me? Oh, I better get out of that before a revival breaks out in this place. I better get. Church, but the very thing I love about my Jesus is he was so secure. He was condescending. He was condescending. He came down. He was living all of the glories of heaven. And he didn't mind leaving heaven. I can imagine if I were in Jesus' place and the Father says, well, son, I want to save them down there. I will look at the Father and say, go right ahead. I'm up here with all the splendor and all the angels beckoning at my call and our sweet fellowship. And you want me to live here and go there? Where they're going to curse me out? Beat me? Spit on me? Reject me? Malign me? And ultimately kill me? You want me to leave this for that? I would have had a huger problem, wouldn't you? But you know, what's even more amazing, when he left heaven, he didn't grit his teeth and say, God, okay, I'll go. Parents, you know how it's like when you tell your kids to do something. Take out the trash or wash them dishes. And they're grumbling and murmuring and rolling their eyes on you like they're going to have a seizure. Not Jesus! The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 12 verse 2, Hebrews chapter 12 verse 2, that he left heaven for the joy set before him. Oh, good Lord. That's why selflessness and not selfishness And that's why being humble and not prideful can make you a joyful person too, like your Jesus. For the joy set before him. Lord, help me preach this message. What was the joy? What was the joy set before him? You, Patsy, was the joy. You, Auntie Iceland, was the joy. Amen. You, Uncle Sam, was the joy. Hey! You, Franzo, was the joy. When Jesus looked at this moment in time, he saw me in this church. He saw you and you and you sitting in this church. And he says, I would rather go to hell for Ty. I would rather go to hell for Neil. I would rather go to hell for Tatenda than to go and be in heaven without them. So I can sing, for me, he died. For me lives and everlasting life. Ooh. Some of you don't even know that song. For me, he died. For me, he lives. An everlasting life and light. He freely what? Yeah. Gives. Thank you, Jesus. The thing that I love about my Jesus is that when he went up, when he came up, came from heaven down to earth, he was so secure that the Bible calls that the incarnation. Everybody say incarnation. Not reincarnation. That's new age stuff. Don't confuse that with this. Tell your neighbor, don't confuse that with this. Incarnation is, I'm teaching you some good theological stuff this morning. I'm teaching you some heavy theological stuff this morning. Incarnation is the Christian doctrine of God becoming a man. And that's what we believe here in this church. Amen? Amen. Listen to me carefully. When the Bible says Jesus Christ, who is God, the second person of the triune God, the Trinity, became a man. When the Bible said he emptied himself, what Paul is talking about here doesn't mean that Jesus stopped being God. It doesn't mean he stopped being God while he was here on earth, like some of your Jehovah's Witnesses friends think and want us to think. You know, Jehovah's Witnesses don't believe that Jesus is God. By the way, they don't come knocking on the door of my house anymore. Because as soon as I open the door, I go, "Hi, Jesus is God!" And they just take off. They leave right away. I'm not kidding you. Somehow my address has been inputted in their system. We haven't seen them in years. When we first came, they would be coming. So they know, don't go to that house. They don't knock on my door like they used to. But emptying himself doesn't mean somehow he became 50% man and 50% God. Half and half. No. Jesus is not half and half. Half and half is what you put in your coffee. Rather, what theologians call the kenosis. The kenosis. What theologians call the kenosis, the emptying, means is set aside the voluntary use of his divine attributes. Kenosis means is set aside the voluntary use of his attributes. You ask, Dr. Tai, did he stop being omniscient? No. I know that because in John chapter 1, verse 48, he said to Nathanael, before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you. That's his omniscience. But at other times, he gave up. He emptied the independent exercise of his omniscience to the point when he says to his disciples in Matthew chapter 24, verse 36, he says to them, but of the day and the hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, that is himself. He said, I don't even know, I, Jesus, don't even know when my return is going to be, but only the Father in heaven knows. What's that? There is kenosising himself, is emptying himself. Did he stop being omnipotent? Again, no. At a moment when they brought him before Pilate, Jesus could have blasted off his enemies to Mars or to Jupiter with just the breath of his mouth. But he emptied himself. You know what you and I would do if we had got such a powers? We'll make the hair shampoo of our haters turn into sulfuric acid. In a moment of our temper, don't pretend like you don't have evil thoughts. Don't pretend like you don't know what I'm talking about. But there are other times when Jesus will pull out his divine powers and say to the waves, hush! Hush! Peace! Be still! Oh, I feel glory. I don't know who the miracle worker Jesus is calming the storm in somebody's sea right now. I said, Jesus is calming the storm in your life right now. If that is you, go ahead and give him your peace, praise. Hush! Hush! There are times when he'll say to a dead man, Lazarus, come forth. And the Bible says, he who was dead came forth, bound hands and... So emptying himself doesn't mean he was half God and half man. No, no, no. He was 100% God and 100% man. He didn't stop being anything. Can you imagine God stop being God? No, no. You don't want God to stop being God. If God ever stopped being God, we are in big trouble. That's what Jehovah's Witnesses don't understand in their thinking. But the thing I really want you to see here as I bring this message to a grand crescendo is why Jesus really humbled himself. Why did he do that? Why did he go to all that extent of condescending? You see, until Jesus came down, until he came down, when you prayed, He couldn't feel your prayer. Now, come on. I didn't say he couldn't hear your prayer. I didn't say he couldn't see your prayer on your situation. I say he couldn't feel it. Because how many know it's one thing to hear about something, it's another thing to feel what you hear about. You can hear about somebody's house burning. If you don't have a house, you don't know what that is. When you said you couldn't handle this cup of suffering you're going through right now, he couldn't feel it. He couldn't feel it. When you said you need sleep and you were tired, he couldn't feel it, because God neither slumber nor sleep. He couldn't feel it. He couldn't be touched by your infirmities, because he is God. He never goes sick. Hey! He's the Ancient of Days. He couldn't, honestly, know what temptation is when you said you're being tempted. Because James says, God cannot be tempted. Ooh. But when he humbled himself, so that when you come to him weak, weary, and tired, broke, busted, and disgusted, the Bible says to tell you, now, everybody say now. According to Hebrews, chapter 4, verse 14 and 15, it says, therefore, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, that's Jesus coming down, who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. What's the confession? Verse 15. Oh, this is going to get good. For we do not have a high priest who cannot before, he couldn't, but now he cannot not sympathize. Oh, with what? Oh, with our weaknesses. But one who has been tempted in some things, a few things. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And yet without sin. Now I know it was for me. He humbled himself so he can be touched by the feelings of my infirmities. Thank you, Lord. See, he had to become like us. I'm almost done. See, if you're married to a crackhead, you almost need to know something of what a crackhead goes through. So when you see him going, that's withdrawal. I don't even know how to do it because I don't know what it is. You almost need to enter into somebody to know what that somebody is going through. Oh, the most beautiful lines, I've heard in this regard is, put it up, a bird and a fish can fall in love. But if they do, where would they live? Come on, talk to me. No. Where would they, think about it. A bird and a fish fall in love. So would a bird live in the water? Or would a fish live in the... and man and God can fall in love. But if they do, where are they going to live? Hey, the Bible says one day God and man fall in love. For God so loved the world. Oh! But where would they live? Because the man could not come up. Since he's fallen so deep in sin. Up here is holy. Down there is mercy. But while you were still swimming in sin, God says, I'll tell you what. I'll fly down. I'll come down into your mess. His mess. Her mess. My mess. Their mess. And I will come where they are. And I will tabernacle. I will sit where they are. Oh, glory to God.
Yes.
Come on, somebody. There's a message. There's a message there for you this morning. And the message is this. The message is this. Don't be afraid to humble yourself. Because if Jesus can humble himself, who himself was God, hey, who indeed in fact lived the glories of heaven, and the angels beckoning at his call, now he has to beg his disciples, his nincompoop disciples, to stay awake with him for just a night. He came down without fighting for his rights. If he can do that, surely you in your less glorious life can let go of your pride, can get over yourself and have the same attitude which is in Christ Jesus. Who is this message for this morning? Because I've got a message. I've got another word for you. I've got another word for you. Watch this. I have another word for you. If you humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, like your Jesus humbled himself under the mighty hand of his Father, the Bible says to tell you, in due time, I say in due time, God will exalt you. Paul, what did you say? Verse 9, chapter 2, verse 9. Therefore, God highly, oh, somebody missed that. Not just exalted. Do you see the superlative? Everybody said highly. He highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, above Buddha's name, above Muhammad's name, above Hare Krishna's name, above Shindu's name. Verse 10, that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow. Hitler, Adolf Hitler will bow. Osama bin Laden will bow. Alexander the Great will bow. Madonna, the material girl, will bow. Shakira will bow. Every knee will bow. You too will bow. If you haven't yet bowed, that at the name of Jesus, he's the name above all names. Oh, at the mention of that name, demons tremble. at the mention of that name, yokes are destroyed. At the mention of that name, chains are broken. At the mention of there's power in that name. Drugs become sober. Addicts become clean. There's healing in that name. Oh, there's salvation in that name too this morning. Acts chapter 4 verse 12 says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there's no other name under heaven given unto man whereby we must be saved. The implication is, except the name of Jesus. I don't know why I can't get off this. Why is the name of Jesus so sweet? Because he is the name above. Hey, call on him when you're in trouble. Call on his name when you're sick. Call on him when your marriage is shaky. Call on his name when you're fired. Call on him when everything within you feels dry. Because he is the one whose cup never runs dry. Oh. Call on him when you are accused. Anybody been accused here this morning? I said, anybody been accused here this morning? Can I get a witness from all those who have called on the name of Jesus in this place? I gotta go. So there won't be any room. See, I told you this is so systematic. So there won't be any room to wiggle around that name. In case some folks want to try to slip through some kind of loopholes, through some kind of way, Paul expands on the every in verse 9 and repeats it twice in verse 10 as if every wasn't enough. He says, every knee will bow first in heaven. You want to cover all the bases anyone can think of. First in heaven, every angels, all the saints of the ages who had gone on before us will bow. And then he says, those on earth who are still living when he comes back again will bow. Saved or unsaved. And then he says, under the earth, even Satan and all his demons will one day bow. That tells me that every day is going to be Sunday in hell. You know how some of your friends think they're going to be partying in hell? Mm-mm-mm. There ain't going to be any party in hell. Every day in hell is going to be a Sunday, because every knee will bow. And then verse 11 concludes at a crescendo, and that every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is what? Somebody shout Lord. To the glory of God the Father. Amen. Amen. That's it, church. That's it, church. He gets all the glory. When he is done, he gets all the glory. He gets all the glory. Because your humiliation, my humiliation, will never lead to disgrace. Our humiliation will finally lead to his exaltation. Welcome back. I trust that message was a blessing to you, as it was a blessing to many people here this morning. And we are talking again about getting over ourselves. But this time, Paul turns it around and he gave us an example of the one who is the name
above every name. That is the title of the message this morning. We're talking about Jesus, who is the one name above every name. And this morning we talked about how we can get over ourselves. As an example of Jesus is for us to be humble. Humility is a word that has gotten bad rep these days. Nobody wants to be humble anymore. Everyone is fighting for number one. But we know that in humility, we can be exalted, as the Bible said. And we see that exaltation in the name that was given to Jesus, the name that is above every name. And this morning, we've learned that we do not need to be afraid to humble ourselves, because in humbling ourselves, we become like Jesus. And in humbling ourselves, God will exalt us as He exalted His Son. Hey, I don't know about you, but I'm working on it. I'm working on it. Let's keep working on it, and God will meet us. He's already come down to where we are, and He will continue to meet us where we are, so that we can finish this race looking only unto Jesus, the author and a finisher of our faith. Let me pray with you right now. Whatever that situation is, if you're still struggling with just humility and surrendering all to Him and making Him your Lord of all, I'm going to pray that prayer with you right now, that Jesus Christ will become Lord of Lord, Lord of all in your life. Because if He's not Lord of all, then He's not Lord at all. Why don't we pray? Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, I thank You for that person who is watching this broadcast this morning. Father, would You please bless them, keep them, and Father, give them that spirit of humility. Lord Jesus, You said You're meek and You're humble at heart, and we will find rest for our soul. And so today we choose rest. We choose to be humble. We choose to humble ourselves before You, God, under Your mighty hand. Help us to humble ourselves in our marriages, in our relationship. Father, in whatever we do, that we will surrender all to You, God. And You would exalt us in due time. Thank You that we can leave it all to You, because You're a good God. You know all things, and You do all things well. And we're trusting and believing in that. That no matter what, we don't need to fight for our own rights, because You, Jesus, never fought for Your rights. So help us to humble ourselves. Now and forevermore, we give You praise. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Amen. Listen, if that message was a blessing to you, why don't you comment us and write us or email us or tweet us or put a message on your comment on the bottom of your screen there on the comment section, and let us know how much you've been blessed. Because when you're blessed, we're blessed, and Jesus is glorified. And we thank you once again for sharing this message with a friend. Come back next week, same time, same station, as we continue on in our series, Looking for Happy. Love you, and have a wonderful week.